Good evening. Welcome to the Northampton City Council meeting of February 2nd, 2017. Happy Groundhog Day. I'm City Council President Bill Dwight, and I'll be presiding tonight. And as our usual custom, what we do is we open with public comment, which is giving the public an opportunity to speak truth to power, if you will. There's a limit to it, however. We ask you keep your comments under 3 minutes. We ask that you address the council, not the audience, but keep your remarks to address the council. We also ask that when you step up, please state your name and your address for the public record. And also to refrain from defaming non-public officials. We're public people. You can defame us and have at it. But if your neighbor annoys you, we don't need to know your neighbor's name if you want to share that with us. By the way, the president's a public figure as well, so just saying. During this time, it's your time to speak. The councilors, so don't direct any questions to us because we are constrained by our rules from answering. So we won't be saying anything. We'll just look at you mutely, and you're going to be frustrated, and I don't want that. So just so you know. One other caveat. As I said, last council meeting, the public comment went for 2.5 hours, and that was good. It was good. But the fact is that many good things were said, and they still resonate, and I don't think they need to be repeated. But if you're so inclined, also if someone says something that you agree with and you were queued up to say the same thing, a simple ditto will pass, and we'll understand. Because we have a big agenda tonight. There's two resolutions. There's a hearing. We have two presentations. And before we even get started, I know a lot of people in the audience here tonight are here for the resolutions principally. There's also a presentation by Catholic Charities relative to the issue of refugee resettlement, and that will come after public comment. And I think you would find it interesting, and it certainly pertains to the conversations that we'll be having about the resolution. All right, let's do this thing. First up, Ken, you ready? Mary, watch your back. Yep, just state your name and your address, please, Ken.
My name is Kenneth Richard Pratt. I live at Salvo House, 81 Conn Street. My full name is Kenneth Richard Pratt, Lieutenant Commander, United States Navy, quasi-retired.
The floor is yours.
To be succinct, I am not so much anti-anything as I am pro-American values. My three grandchildren are Mexican American, Chinese American, and American American. I served my country in Vietnam. I served my state at the Department of Mental Retardation, and have always been involved in multiculturalism, which I feel strengthens our company, our country. Our about 400 years ago, almost to the date, a number of almost everyone here's ancestors landed at Plymouth Rock seeking religious freedom. I would remind folks of our Constitution, our social contract, our covenant, First Amendment. Congress shall make no law respecting religion. Thank you for your attention, and I'm very pleased with the crowd.
Thank you so much.
Good night.
Good night. Billy Peard, please. Billy? And did I pronounce, and everyone's entitled to tell me I pronounced their, I mangled their name, so.
Thank you, that's correct.
Okay. So if you could repeat your name and your address, please.
Billy Peard, I'm a resident of Holyoke, Massachusetts. In a professional capacity as an attorney, I represent clients here in the city of Northampton. And that's the reason I come to you tonight. I rise in support of a resolution I believe is before you related to wage theft. I wanted to thank the council up to this point, as I understand there's been an immense amount of leadership on this topic over the past year. And I rise as a employment attorney who represents low-wage workers in employment disputes both here and in Northampton and throughout the valley, including many of our immigrant brothers and sisters who are most deeply affected by other world events during the past week, but for years and years have been affected by the constant threat of wage theft, which happens in all communities, but happens here to an alarming rate. Wage theft, many studies have shown in recent years, is responsible for more loss to theft than all other property crimes combined. Car thefts, home invasions, burglaries, street thefts, all those crimes combined pale in comparison to the amount of money that is lost to victims as the result of wage theft nationwide. We don't have numbers for here in Northampton, but I suspect the proportions are roughly similar here in Northampton. Unlike property crimes, wage theft in most jurisdictions does not accompany a more traditional law enforcement approach. So the police do not typically investigate wage theft. If they do find that someone is guilty of wage theft, if they find that an employer is guilty of wage theft, that employer is very rarely at risk of actually being prosecuted criminally or going to jail. By contrast, someone who steals $250 through means of a bad check or a home invasion is a felony in the state of Massachusetts, over $250. So there's a big disproportionate response under the law how we deal with traditional property crimes and those forms of crime that take place in the workplace and which are much more prevalent. So I applaud the City Council up to this point in their leadership on this issue. I think it's fair to say, without naming names, that the next 4 years are going to be more difficult in terms of enforcement at the federal level. So all the more important that we step it up on the local and state level in terms of the mechanisms we put into place for wage enforcement. Even under the best of times, under the Obama administration, for example, there are only 1,100 wage and hour investigators employed by the federal government nationwide for 120 plus million American workers to enforce our minimum wage and our overtime and our child labor laws. So we really do need leadership at the state and local level. So I applaud the efforts here in Northampton to do just that. Thank you.
Thank you. Rose Bookbinder. Rose. You want to pass. Is it Tori Hall?
Ditto.
Thank you. Tori Hall? Tony Hall?
Thanks. Hello, my name is Tony Hall. I live at 20 Glenwood Avenue here in Northampton. I want to thank you for your support of the resolution. You saw me here 2 weeks ago asking you to pass it. And I just wanted to take a moment to reflect on my history of working here in Northampton. I've had some really great bosses and some really hard ones. And at some times when I've had some really hard bosses, I've turned to my coworkers, and I look at people all around me now and people that came in with me tonight, and we are asking for a Band-Aid here. And I think that I just wanted to come in here tonight and remind that this is a Band-Aid. And we, the working class, need Band-Aids so we can stand up and fight. And so this is a tiny step, a tiny Band-Aid to keep us going and keep this longer trajectory happening. And I wanted to thank you for that and thank all of you for that. And also keep in mind that there's a lot more to do. And to look backwards a little bit, I remember coming in here when this city was proposing to criminalize free speech. If we were going to ask for money, that was going to become criminalized here. We got to keep these things in mind, that this used to be something we thought was okay, And now, after today, hopefully, we used to think that wage theft was okay. By forgetting that it was happening, by not noticing that it was happening, we were thinking it was okay. We've lost a lot of people who live in the street here in the Valley in the past 10 years since I've lived here. And I think that a Band-Aid like tonight is really important so that this movement can keep going and so we don't keep losing people and so we don't keep losing people from our city who have a lot of value. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Adam Garfield, please.
Hello, good evening. My name is Adam Garfield. I live at 22 Highland Avenue, Northampton, Massachusetts. Right. I'll try to keep this relatively short since I seem to be in support of most of the things here tonight. My name is Adam Garfield, and I represent the Joint Council of the United Auto Workers, Local 2322. UAW 2322 is an amalgamated local representing 4,300 workers, primarily in Western Massachusetts, 28 workplaces. We are a diverse local representing people in a wide range of cultural, economic, educational, national backgrounds in the Pioneer Valley, as well as areas of New Hampshire and Vermont. Some of our workers that live in your constituency include social service counselors, direct care staff, child care workers, nurse and health specialists, and of course, teacher assistants and postdoctoral workers. We are here today as a labor body of constituents in your city to endorse both the Fair Employment Resolution and ordinance. Without repeating many of the comments said here delivered tonight and previously in the last meeting, as a union, we feel it is necessary to underline and stress the need for accountability of employers who choose to use illegal loopholes and pay wages off the books to circumvent taxation and the pay of a sustainable wage. Like many here tonight, we count on this governing body to stand up for the intent of our labor law system, given the political environment ahead. This is not a reverberation of empty rhetoric. As we know, over time, Andy Puzder, as Secretary of Labor, will push forward an agenda of deregulation of the current labor system with the goal of national right to work and contingent labor for all. This is why we stand with the larger coalition of labor advocates in the Pioneer Valley in support of these minimal labor accountability measures. As we applaud you for previously passing them, and we ask you to do the right thing today, we also call on you to take the next step forward and find any other way within the realm of your power to protect low-wage, contingent, and or undocumented workers within the city limits. If we do not do more than the minimum of what is required to protect the ones we love and work in our city, how can we call ourselves a sanctuary city, let alone a progressive one? Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Dane Cutler?
Yep, that's Dane Cutler. I live at 47 Orchard Street. Hi, Jim. So you are more than a city council at this moment. If you choose to be, you get to be an arm of the resistance. There's a lot that I was going to say, and most of it has been said, so I'll spare you. Except to say this, that we as constituents are going to demand more from you than we have before, if that's possible. That we are going to ask you to take stronger stances, to pass more than resolutions, more than ordinances, to act within the full capacity that you have as a city council to be our voices. We are a city in this era of resistance, by and large. If we can't count on you to extend that and to become the furthering of our own resistance, we're coming for your jobs. I mean it. There have been so many calls to people who've never run for public office before to run for public office. So we're a lot less scared of that. So all I'm saying is step up. Do us proud. Don't make us run for public office.
Deanna, are you here? I saw you. There you are. Okay, got buried. Okay.
So my name is Deanna Sierra. I live on 3 Edward Square in Northampton. And I want to take a different angle. I know that I spoke in a very emotional and passionate manner at the city council meeting 2 weeks ago, but I feel the need to speak again because I'm not just here for myself, but I'm here for the undocumented immigrant workers who can't be here today because they're either too scared to speak to you today or they're at work. And I feel that since I was a kid, I've been always finding myself in this capacity, whether translating, being the one small kid translating for immigrant parents into English. And now as an organizer, I'm still in that capacity translating about what their rights are and what their needs are. And I think it bears repeating about the extent to which wage theft is a problem in this town, in this progressive town. 95% of workers do not receive paid sick days, and 65% of workers are not making overtime when they work in excess of 40 hours. And I said it before, but it needs to be repeated. Wage theft is at the intersection of white supremacy and economic exploitation under capitalism. And it will be worse under Trump when we have openly neo-Nazi, white supremacist people in power who are against immigrants and who do not believe in upholding the most basic of minimum wage and hour laws. So you do have power here. And as a historian, I'm also a historian, that's what we do. We look at documents from the past, meeting minutes from a city government meetings, resolutions that were made, and we have an analysis of what actions people took in critical moments in history, or what inactions. Sometimes that speaks louder, the inactions that people, they fail to step up. And so you will be judged. And it was those small inactions or actions that led us to where we are, and it's going to be those everyday actions that lead us to the future. So if you vote in favor of this resolution, the Fair Employment City Resolution, it is a vote against racism, it is a vote against justice, and it's a vote for you to be part of something larger than yourselves. And so I'll just leave it at that, and I hope that after this meeting I can go home to a victory. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Teresa Copeland, please.
Hello, I'm Teresa Copeland. I live at 49 Orchard Street in Ward 3. I'm here with other members of my local Carpenters, the Carpenters Union Local 108 in Springfield. I'm here to support the wage theft resolution that you guys are having a final vote on tonight. Wage theft impacts a lot of hospitality workers in Northampton, and it also impacts construction workers all over the state. I hope you will remember the very long public comment we had 2 weeks ago that I spoke at and many other people spoke at, and I hope you will vote in favor of it. Thank you.
Thank you very much. That's all I have signed up. Is there anyone else interested in speaking on any matter? Okay. So here's the process. What I'm going to do is I'm going to ask the administrative assistant to call the roll. We're going to determine that there's a quorum, and we set to voting, but there will be a few items that come up before we actually get to the resolutions. And as I said, I strongly recommend you paying attention to the presentation from Catholic Charities relative to refugee resettlement in this area. That said, Pam, would you please call the roll?
Councilor Bidwell.
Here.
Present.
Councilor
White. Here.
Councilor Klein.
Here.
Councilor Labarge.
Present.
Councilor Murphy.
Here.
Councilor Nash.
Here.
Councilor O'Donnell.
Here.
Councilor Sherrod.
Here.
We do have a quorum. Go figure. All righty. First, actually scheduled up, this is riveting, but you'll please pay attention. This is all part of the process. We have a public hearing that was scheduled. This is a item 16.205. It's a public hearing regarding a poll petition received from Verizon. And this is in accordance with the provisions of Section 22, Chapter 166 of the Massachusetts General Laws. And a public hearing will be held tonight on the petition of Verizon New England to erect a line of poles with wires and fixtures on Rust Avenue in Northampton. I'll accept a motion.
Make a motion.
The motion's made and seconded to open public hearing. Someone leaned against the light switch, so if you, there you go.
There we go.
Are there any proponents here for the... poll petition. Looks like Lisa's going to come. Lisa's. Oh, there we go. All right. Hi.
Good evening.
Name is Paul Davis. I work for a company by the name of UC Synergetic out of Sunderland. We're a contract work engineering company doing contract work for Verizon, and I'm here representing Verizon tonight on their behalf.
Could you describe the scope of work?
Yeah, basically, long story short, is there's an existing pole in Rust Ave that's being moved 6 feet to the property line. I'll get the address for you here.
Yeah, 23 Rust Ave.
Yeah, it's being moved to the property line between 23 and 13 Rust Ave to make space for a driveway.
Any questions? Councilor O'Donnell.
I'm probably going to repeat back to you most of what you just said, but just to make absolutely sure, because the petition, as you know, was revised after the first draft at the request of one of the resident of 13 Rust Avenue. Mm-hmm. So I just want to make sure that absolutely the pole is going, as you say, between the two property lines. I know the petition has the word approximately in there. I just want to make sure that it's less approximately, more definitely.
6 feet, yeah. If you're facing the pole, 6 feet to the right to the property line.
All right. Right. Thank you very much.
Any other questions?
I just want to point out that Verizon did submit a revised pole petition request, which is the one that you have in your packet.
Yep. So that thank you, and I just wanted to confirm that was the case. Thank you. So I move to close the public. Oh, unless there are opponents.
Are there any opponents? Okay. I'll accept your motion to close the public hearing. Oh, yep.
I'm not an opponent.
That's okay. If you're speaking neutral or whatever, you're welcome to speak. So.
Thank you. My name is David Payne, 13 Rust Avenue. So I am that neighbor. I just wanted to make sure it appears that, because the original location of the pole was toward my property, and I want to make sure it was on the line exactly, on the street line in that divides my property from the adjacent property. I haven't seen a diagram or a map that indicates that, but the verbal description, as I've heard, it says that's what it is. Am I right?
Councilor Brown.
And we have a Verizon representative, but the map that I have does show it between 13 and 23.
What's the 6 feet?
You can see up here.
There it is.
There we go.
The distance it would be moved, I take it.
From where it currently is.
Where it was currently proposed, okay. Yeah.
Looks good to me.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
Democracy in action.
Democracy in action. Anyone else who wishes to speak on this? There was a motion to close the public hearing. Is there a second?
Like a second.
All those in favor of closing the public hearing, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Okay, we'll vote later on that in the agenda. I'm going to bypass one-minute announcements, if everyone will bear with me. So we have communications from the mayor. The mayor is here to discuss, among other things, his wage law compliance executive policy orders, Your Honor.
Good evening, members of the City Council, members of the public. I do believe one of the things on communications from the mayor, we're going to push off to a future meeting. Right.
That's the broadband study municipal exactly. Network strategy.
So I will, I guess I could just get these to you and pass out and see how many work. So again, as part of this effort that the City Council has engaged in relative to wage law compliance and the conversations that I've had with counselors and the city solicitor. Today I have signed two executive policy orders relative to the first is a policy order establishing wage law compliance certification requirements for procurement and contracts. I won't read you the language because it's a lot of legalese, but it's 2 pages long. And essentially this deals with the issue of requests for proposals, bids, contracts, any procurement that the city does, and that as part of the many certifications that we already require from businesses or contractors that we work with, we will be adding provisions that require them to certify that they comply with wage laws.
And there's a series of measures built in and certification requirements. And similar to the council order, the requirement that if they do have any findings against them in the last 3 years, that there is the opportunity to provide a bond for wages that's in there. So very, very similar, mirroring the resolution that you have. The second one, similarly, executive policy order establishing wage law compliance certification requirements for tax increment financing, or TIF, those projects that the mayor and economic development development director bring forward to the city council from time to time when businesses seeking to expand an existing business may be eligible for relief through a tax increment financing agreement with the city. Similarly, we typically have an agreement with applicants that puts requirements around you know, financing and around job creation, et cetera. This would add an additional requirement as part of the application process that they would indeed be in compliance with wage laws and would certify such and would remain in compliance during the period that they are benefiting from the tax increment financing. So you can see it's in detail. I have posted these on the city's website. They're on the home page of the city's website. And so I just wanted to communicate that to you tonight. And that signing of those today will likely correspond with the passage of the resolution tonight and the adoption of the order that you have before me, which I intend to sign if the city council passes that tonight. I intend to sign it. So that's my communication.
Questions or comments? It should be noted that for folks who are trying to understand the scope of power and the assignment of power and the division of powers in the city of Northampton, the mayor is the executive authority, and thereby he has authority over most of the procurement, almost all of it, with a few exceptions. And the few exceptions that the city council does have, we've created an ordinance that we'll be voting on in second reading tonight about
order.
Excuse me?
Order.
I'm sorry. Thank you. Yes, an order tonight that will replicate that. So what you're witnessing is basically two quarters of this whole package. It's, and then in two other committees that have different authorities, which is the Community Preservation Committee and the License Board, they will be discussing something that would probably tie in with this as well and enhance this. So this comprehensive package actually does, in fact, actually create by law and order in the executive order rules and consequences. So not just the resolution. Is there anything else, Your Honor?
I didn't know if anyone had questions.
Councilor Nash.
So what are some typical contractors who have to, you know, what kind of work are we talking about?
Road paving, you know, any kinds of construction, you know, major construction projects that we do. Obviously building construction when we have building construction projects. That would be, you know, that sort of a contract, but it could also be procurement of equipment, procurement of, you know, school supplies, et cetera. The idea being that if we're going to allocate tax dollars and city resources, that the companies with which we do business should be in compliance with all state and federal regulations. And we already do seek certification for a number of different legal requirements as part of procurement. We do have requirements already in our RFPs, and, you know, we do seek you know, certification around things like workers' comp and other kinds of certification. So this would just be adding one additional layer onto that.
This is great.
Anything else? Okay. Councilor Dunn.
I was going to suggest a slight reordering of the agenda.
Okay.
And that would be, to, as last meeting, to take the two the resolution and the order relative to wage theft first. And then I would suggest maybe the presentation from Catholic Charities might precede the resolution on the order relative to the president's executive order. Would that kind of improve the flow and people's schedules? And
well, I know Councilor Klein's keen on that. So any objections, let's say.
Okay.
So folks playing along at home, we're just changing the order of the agenda a little bit. So that we'll bring those resolutions that most of you who have spoken tonight seem to be expressly interested in. Following that will be the presentation that I referred to, and then also a new resolution that we'll be discussing that Ken spoke to in the beginning, which is the resolution condemning President Trump's January 27th executive order, quote, protecting the nation from foreign terrorist entry into the United States, close quote. So you may want to stick around for that too. So we're combining the order. So we have item 17.234, that's the resolution declaring Northampton a fair employment city. And then we're also bringing up item
235.
Is it 235, yeah. So item 17.235, that's an order regarding wage compliance certificates and license. So, and those are both in second reading. So I would accept, you want to, we have to separate.
Which number?
Yeah.
Types of votes. So I'll accept a motion on the first, on the resolution.
Move to approve the resolution.
Second.
This is the resolution, get back to it, declaring Northampton a fair employment city. Motion's made in second. Any further discussion on this item? Councilor
would it be helpful because of the interest in this to summarize the three amendments that were agreed to as friendly amendments?
But I would appreciate that, yes.
But that I was asked to reflect in slightly revised language, so I'll review that. And everyone who looked at your agendas online, there's both for the old version showing the changes and then a clean version showing the recommended new version. And basically, when we talked about this 2 weeks ago, we were all very, very supportive of the measure, but there was agreement that it could perhaps be even stronger and clearer. And so I was asked to craft some language that would do three things. One was to make it clear exactly what the city council could do and what we are asking of the Community Preservation Committee and the Licensing Commission. And that is that we are in position for licensees coming here to require that they certify compliance with wage and hour laws. It's not in our capacity, in our ability, in our powers to ensure that these things would happen, to guarantee these things would happen. So for purposes of clarity, a couple of references to ensure and guarantee were removed and replaced with this very specific language, exactly what it is that we are in position to do. And the second was that we talked about the fact that we wanted to build into this resolution some recognition and appreciation for the very, very many businesses and employers in Northampton that are in compliance, are in conscientious compliance with wage and hour laws. And so there is an additional whereas clause that makes that point. And then the third was that since it's really the Attorney General's office where a great deal of the actual investigative and enforcement power lies, this resolution would also put us on record as supporting the pending state legislation that would provide additional tools and additional resources to the Attorney General's office to investigate and enforce the wage and hour laws that we're talking about. So it's really those three types of changes that are now embodied in the revised language. So I hope that is clear.
Why don't I go to the sponsors first, and then, so Councilor Carney, then Councilor Klein, and then Councilor O'Donnell.
I just have a question procedurally. Since those are amendments, do we need to actually,
We should introduce and apply the amendments,
yeah.
And the question is, are these friendly amendments?
I accepted them as friendly amendments last week. Well, that they weren't offered specifically, but.
And Councilor Klein?
I just have a slew of scribbler errors that I wanted corrected in the final version. I mean, I know this is the final version, but I think we can still make those corrections, correct?
Absolutely, yes.
Yeah, so I'm just going to go through them, and it's rather tedious, and I apologize. So the whereas, the city of Northampton has the opportunity to lead by example and present a model of economic and social responsibility and sustainability. We need a semicolon before the and. I said this was tedious and I wasn't kidding. And then down from there, there are two whereases that need the ands. Whereas the city desires that potential and current recipients, Pam, you see that?
Yeah.
We need an and there, and then the one immediately following needs an and. Two down from that, a resolve. Be it resolved, vendors, contracts who have been shown to violate. We have an extra period there at the end before the semicolon. And then just a general question, from the resolutions that we have been passing, we haven't done ands for the resolves. We've only done them for the whereases, and we've ended them in periods. So I'm wondering if we want to remain consistent in doing that and put periods at the end of all of those. Just for consistency's sake with the rest, or if it doesn't matter, that's right. Okay too.
I mean, actually, if you go back and historically look at the resolutions, you'll see that they take a hodgepodge variety of formats, and we have been trying to be more consistent. So I think in the interest of being consistent that we
actually I put a word that was missing, and now I can't remember what it was, and I didn't mark it. So if anyone else sees something like that, there was a preposition missing somewhere. Shoot, sorry.
While you're looking for that, what I'll do is Councilor Bidwell's amended whereas, the additional one that he referred to is, whereas the city of Northampton is proud to be home to a great many high road employers, including the hospitality service and construction industries that are in compliance with applicable wage and hour laws and are deserving of the community support and patronage. So that has been added to this, and that's the one of the most significant changes in the document.
And then there's an additional resolve that's been added also.
Right.
The second to last resolve.
Second to last one is, be it further resolved, the city of Northampton calls on the city of Northampton License Commission.
Mm.
Is that the one?
No. Regarding the state legislative representatives.
I'm sorry, yeah. That the city council calls upon the city state legislative representatives to vigorously support pending legislation to provide the Commonwealth's Attorney General with additional enforcement powers and resources regarding wage theft matters, as well as to increase the penalties for violations. Councilor O'Donnell.
Just on process, it's my belief that we should actually vote on this amendment. I mean, a friendly amendment would be okay if we hadn't taken any action. We've already passed this on first reading, so even though the sponsors agree, we all must agree. So
right. No, I'm
so we are going to do that?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. I'm sorry. I understood it to be we were just adopting it without it.
No. And I think, yeah, and it should be noted that the amendments, the amendments were requested, and also they're not a significant change from the body, but they do require us to understand the amendments as they stand and then to vote on them for or again. So with that in mind, I'm going to read the amended version if everyone's okay with that. Is Does that sound all right? And now, while Councilor Bidwell described the color of the amendments, he didn't describe the specific changes in the deletions and the inclusions. So, and they're not marked here on this document that I have, even the redlined one. It does. I just see deletions of words, but I don't see the additions, and so I'm just having to assume the additions. So, actually, Councilor Bidwell, would you read this and then point out what the amended language is?
Yes, I'd be glad to do so, because in my printout, depends on which version of Word you're using, as I've discovered, and which view of it, which readout, but I have a version here that will allow me, I think, to point out the changes.
Okay. Have at it.
Upon the recommendation of Councilor Lisa Klein and Councilor Maureen Carney, as amended by Councilor Dennis P. Bidwell, a resolution declaring Northampton a fair employment city. Whereas the residents of and visitors to the city of Northampton annually spend hundreds of thousands of dollars purchasing food, apparel, and other goods, and whereas locally owned businesses provide essential employment opportunities and contribute to the character and unique identity of our community, and whereas fair employment practices, and deleted there is the word ensuring. It had read whereas ensuring fair employment practices. Now it just says whereas fair employment practices in Northampton provide workers with the rights to which they are entitled under both state and federal law, consumers with the knowledge that those who serve them are treated ethically, and local businesses an enhanced opportunity to make a positive economic and social impact in our communities, and whereas providing decent worker conditions. And the previous version said whereas ensuring decent working conditions. Now reads whereas providing decent working conditions and fair wages for workers is an essential part of investment in local economies and sustainable employment practices, and whereas the practice commonly known as wage theft, improperly withholding payment from employees and failing to pay them in accordance with state and federal wage and hour laws, harms the well-being of workers, their families, and their communities, as well as the reputation of employers, and whereas low-income and immigrant workers and workers who are non-native English speakers are most vulnerable to this practice, and whereas workers in the hospitality service industry are also vulnerable to this practice, and whereas the misclassification of employees as independent contractors presents one of the most serious problems facing affected workers in the construction industry, and misclassified workers often are denied access to critical benefits and protections to which they are entitled, such as the minimum wage, overtime compensation, family and medical leave, unemployment insurance, and safe workplaces, and whereas the high cost of wage theft to the city, its business community, and its residents impedes the city's economic development and growth, and whereas the city of Northampton has the opportunity to lead by example and present a model of economic and social responsibility and sustainability, and whereas the city of Northampton expresses its support for sustainable and equitable commerce, construction, and economic development, and this next whereas is all new language. Whereas the city of Northampton is proud to be home to a great many, quote, high road, quote, employers, including in the hospitality service and instruction industries, that are in compliance with applicable wage and hour laws and are deserving of the community's support and patronage. And whereas the city desires that potential and current recipients, and it had read, whereas the city desires to ensure that potential and current recipients, now it's whereas the city desires that potential and current recipients of licenses issued under General Law Chapter 138 and Chapter 140, and recipients of Community Preservation Act funds and tax increment financing comply with applicable wage laws. And whereas the City of Northampton, in its Buy Local, Buy Fair resolution, April 17, 2008, recognizes the important role that local businesses have in the diversity and sustainability of our economy and is strongly committed to protecting our local business base. Now, therefore, be it resolved that the City Council of Northampton, Massachusetts, decrees Northampton a fair employment city in the United States, and be it further resolved that is authorized under Mass General Law Chapter 30B and Chapter 149, Section 44, the City of Northampton should award contracts for goods and services. Before it had said award bids, award contracts for goods and services in public construction only to, and the only was added, only to responsible contractors. And then there was a new phrase at the end, responsible contractors who certify their compliance with wage and hour laws. That's a new phrase. And be it further resolved that in the City of Northampton, vendors and or contractors who have been shown to, and before it just read contractors who violate the state and federal wage laws. Now it says contractors who have been shown to violate the state and federal wage and hour laws should be deemed not responsible and therefore should not be awarded contracts from the City of Northampton. And be it further resolved that the City Council, before it said we, now it says the City Council endorses an executive policy order addressing these issues with regard to procurement and tax increment financing. And be it further resolved that the City Council, as opposed to we, calls on the City of Northampton License Commission to require, as opposed to ensure, require that applicants for licenses pursuant to Mass General Law Chapter 138 or Mass General Law Chapter 140 certify compliance with applicable wage and hour laws. And be it further resolved that, did say we, now says the City Council calls on the Community Preservation Committee to require, as opposed to ensure, that applicants for Community Preservation Act funding, as well as any contractors and subcontractors on these publicly supported projects, certify compliance with applicable wage laws and certify that they don't, as opposed to ensure that contractors used. It would now read, certify that they don't have a recent history of wage theft and tax fraud. And then this next is a totally new whereas. Be it further resolved that the City Council calls upon the city's state legislative representatives to vigorously support pending legislation to provide the Commonwealth's Attorney General with additional enforcement powers and resources regarding wage theft matters, as well as to increase penalties for violations. And, or this is the final one, thanks for bearing with me, be it further resolved that the administrative assistant to the City Council shall cause a copy of this resolution to be sent to the City of Northampton Community Preservation Committee, City of Northampton License Commission, and then what was added to this was State Representative Peter Cocott and State Senate President Stan Rosenberg.
So I'll accept.
There it is.
Thank you. Well done. And I'll accept the motion on the amendments.
I'll make that motion. Second.
Second. We have second, second, and second. Okay. So discussion on the amendments. Councilor O'Donnell.
I think they're excellent. I appreciate the sponsor's original work and Councilor Bidwell's work, which makes it much, much better and clearer. So it's great.
It's probably appropriate at this point that this is based on requests. Council LaBarge requested the response from the Chamber of Commerce, and this is from Suzanne Beck on behalf of the Greater Chamber, the Greater Northampton Chamber of Commerce. I'm writing on behalf of the Chamber of Commerce to provide some comment on the resolution declaring Northampton a fair employment city. I regret that I'm out of town and not able to give this testimony in person. I will also request that a member of the council or alternate read this testimony into the record of the meeting, and that would be me. I'll open by calling the public's attention to one of the opening statements of this resolution. Whereas the locally owned businesses provide essential employment opportunities and contribute to the character and unique identity of our community, close quote. I call out this clause because it is the one whereas clause of the 10 that are in the resolution that speaks to the whole of the business community that deserves to be acknowledged by the chamber and our community. It is also the only phrase that codifies the city's intent to narrow the focus of the resolution to a few instances of unlawful practices that it intends to address. The Chamber and our community are proud of the business community's contribution to the character of the community, proud of its contribution to our residents and service organizations that businesses invest in, and proud of every job it provides, proud of the service and accomplishment of its employees, proud of the livelihoods and economic opportunity that support our families. This is an important point, and I hope it will be an important emphasis on your comments that preface your vote. And put it on the back. I'll also acknowledge that the council has taken into consideration the testimony of the chamber, businesses, and others by putting your response to the findings of the Community Resources Committee in the form of a resolution and not an ordinance with the enforcement and resources that would be necessary to carry it out. Respectfully, Suzanne Beck, Executive Director of the Greater Chamber, the Greater Northampton Chamber of Commerce. Any other questions? This is to the amendments. Okay, all those in favor of the amendment?
I just wanted to ask, when we're voting on this, I took out the ands in the resolved paragraph based on what you had said, so how Councillor Bidwell read it. So
right.
I didn't read it with all the right
the scrivener errors.
Ands, but if those are friendly amendments to a friendly amendments.
Let's try this again. As amended with the scrivener's errors, is there a motion to put it on the floor for the amendments?
We did that. I think we're getting ready to
rephrase.
We are. I'm just including the scrivener's errors just to dot the I's.
Okay.
Second.
Okay. And any more discussion on the scrivener's errors? Okay. To the amended language, including the scrivener's errors. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Any abstentions? Okay. Now, back to the order. Further discussion.
I just want to thank everybody who contributed in discussion around this in the last couple of weeks, and especially Councillor Bidwell, that really clarified and spoke to the original intent of the resolution, especially to call out support for those employers that we know are doing the right thing and asking folks to support them. So I just want to, again, thank everybody who worked on this and thank the mayor for his executive order tonight. It seems like we're moving towards a complete package, and I'm looking forward to that.
Councilor Klein.
I want to thank the mayor for the executive order. Is he here somewhere?
And
in the back.
We don't get to, as the council president explained, we don't get to talk back to the people who come and speak to us, but I want to take this opportunity to thank the public for their input, because it has been extremely valuable for this process, working with the Pioneer Valley Worker Center and others on this piece of resolution has been really important, but also just hearing from folks in the community who support it has really galvanized, I think, our resolve on the council. So thank you to all of you.
And well, Councilor Labarge.
Yes, I also want to thank everybody for being here. The transparency of having residents coming in to city council is very, very valuable. And I also want to say I want to thank Councilor Bidwell, because I felt in honoring our businesses who are and abide by the law should be on here and should be recognized. So I thank you for adding that statement in here. I think it's very, very valuable. And I also want to thank our council president, Bilge White, and reading off that letter from the chamber.
Anyone else? Councilor Bidwell.
Just one procedural item I should have noted. I was asked to run these drafts past the city solicitor, and I did so. Alan Seawald and I had a conversation last week. He had a couple of his own little very, very, very tiny tweaks, but this passes muster what we've just been talking about with the city solicitor.
Anyone else? I would like to add that this actually is a source of pride. The resolution, but also, more importantly, the words that actually have effect. This is, resolutions, of course, are, as Councilor Murphy explained last time, essentially expression of our will and our intent. There's basically a request from us to go out and ask people to abide by the law, which seems, as I said before, it seems rather strange that we're actually bending over backwards to ask people to stop stealing from other people. And that does seem kind of absurd, but it needs doing. And I'm glad we're doing it. I'm proud of that. I'm particularly grateful for the two sponsors who put this wasn't cobbled together in a matter of weeks. This is a long, very complicated, nuanced process that spoke to a lot of constituencies with a lot of varying agendas and priorities. And I think in working with the executive office and working with the public, they've actually crafted a rather impressive array of rules that, you know, in other countries they just do by fiat if they feel like it. And as we seem to, and this is my editorial comment, as we start to move toward more governance by fiat, I take the public's comment about, you know, holding us to account, I take that with the intent that it was delivered. I understand that. We should be, and I appreciate you holding us to account. I actually appreciate you paying attention. To that end, and I'm going to make a pitch for Councillor Murphy. Councillor Murphy is about to preside over a very unsexy process called the budget. And we want the public to come and attend the budget. The budget is our moral document. This is what we preside over. It expresses what we value and what we invest in. And I encourage anyone and everyone to come and speak to it. Declare what your values are. Emphasize there, because as I said, it's not especially sexy. It doesn't come with a lot of flowery speeches, but it actually is the one thing that actually has the most direct effect that we have any power or authority over. And if you are planning on running for office, and I actually do hope you do, I hope people will consider that. I mean, we don't want to get to the point where people are sentenced to serve. We want people to actually step up and serve. But the budget's the thing. It is the thing. And it is a moral document. All that said, thank you all very much. And I'm going to ask the administrative assistant to call the roll on second reading for this resolution.
Councillor Bidwell.
Yes.
Councillor Carney.
Yes.
Councillor Dwight.
Yes.
Councillor Klein.
Yes.
Councillor LaBarge.
Yes.
Councillor Murphy.
Yes.
Councillor Nash.
Yes.
Councillor O'Donnell.
Yes.
Councillor Sherrick.
Yes.
It passes unanimously in second. So next up, we have item 17.235. This is an order, and this is the order regarding wage compliance and certificates and licensure. And there are no amendments attached to this or proposed for this.
No, there are.
There are. Yep. I will defer to Councillor Bidwell to present the amendments, please. Oh, yes, I'm sorry. I'm sorry.
It is confusing. There's two versions of it. Yeah. It's the same as the other one.
A motion first, or?
Yeah, accept a motion for.
Second.
Motion's made in second. It's on the floor. Now you may propose your amendments.
I'll do the same thing as I did before. I'll read it through, noting what is different from what was approved 2 weeks ago, what was voted on 2 weeks ago. Are you sure I've got the right version in front of me? Okay. Wait a minute. Hang on just one second. I want to get this right. Okay. Upon the recommendation of Councillor Lisa Klein and Councillor Maureen Carney, as amended by Councillor Dennis Bidwell, 17.235, in order, it now reads wage compliance certificates required for licenses, which is a slight change from its original wording as a title that I think a little more accurately reflects. Before it was an order wage compliance certificates in license. So it's just a little clearer as a title. Ordered that, whereas the practice commonly known as wage theft, improperly withholding payment from employees and failing to pay them according to required schedules, harms the well-being of employees, their families, and their communities, and whereas low-income immigrant and limited English proficient workers are most vulnerable to this practice, and whereas workers in the hospitality service industry and the construction industry, and I added the phrase and the construction industry, are also vulnerable to this practice, whereas the high cost of wage theft to the city, its business community, and its residents impedes the city's economic development and growth, and whereas the city desires that potential and current recipients, and before it had read desires to ensure the potential and current recipients of licenses issued under General Law Chapter 140 comply with applicable wage laws. Now, therefore, pursuant to the authority invested in the City Council of the City of Northampton, by Statute 2012, Chapter 277, Article 2, and every other power hereto enabling the City Council, hereby orders and directs as follows. And again, there's the title, Wage Compliance Certificates Required for Licenses. The Northampton City Council, and this is a phrase moved from the end of the sentence to the start of the sentence, the Northampton City Council, in determining whether to issue, reissue, modify, suspend, or revoke a license under General Law Chapter 140, it had said, may consider whether, it now says, shall require that, a potential or current licensee, it had said, has been, now it says, certify that they are not, subject to a federal or state criminal or civil judgment, administrative citation, order, or final administrative determination resulting from a violation of General Law Chapter 149, Chapter 151, or the Fair Labor Standards Act. The City Council may require a wage bond or insurance be posted by any potential licensee who, it now reads, who does not certify that they are not subject to, pardon the double negative, but I think that's the right way to put it, as opposed it had been, potential licensee has been subject to a federal or state criminal or civil judgment, administrative citation, order or final administrative determination resulting from a violation of General Law Chapter 149, Chapter 151, or the Fair Labor Standards Act. Licensees that are subject to a state or federal debarment for violation of the above laws, either voluntarily or involuntarily, or that have been prohibited from contracting with the Commonwealth or any of its agencies or subdivisions, shall be prohibited from holding or continuing to hold licenses issued under General Law Chapter 140 for the entire period of debarment or other stated time period.
I'll accept a motion on the amendment.
So moved.
Second. Discussion on the amendments? Councilor Klein?
Scrivener error stuff.
Damn you.
The first sentence in the end paragraph, suspend or revoke a license. There's a period there, so under, I think that period is unnecessary.
Before under, between license and under.
Right. And then we're missing a period after or the Fair Labor Standards Act.
Okay, well, we'll conserve that period and move it to, we'll delete it from one and then move it to the other. That's it?
That's it. Yeah.
Anything else? Okay. Now the amended amendments include the Scrivener's error. So,
I'll just make the same note that this too is reviewed with the city solicitor and he has signed off on it.
So discussion on the amendments? Any more? All those in favor of the amendments, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Any opposed? Any abstentions? Back to the order. Any further discussion? Pam, would you please call the roll?
Councilor Carney.
Yes.
Councilor Dwight.
Yes.
Councilor Klein.
Yes.
Councilor LaBarge.
Yes.
Councilor Murphy.
Yes.
Councilor Nash.
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell.
Yes.
Councilor Sheriff.
Yes.
Councilor Tidwell.
Yes.
That too passes in second reading, and it is. Okay. Now, by request, we're going to move to item B in the presentations. This is the Refugee Resettlement Initiative given by Catholic Charities. Catherine, you are here. The floor is yours.
Thank you very much, and thank you for asking me to come and speak with you. As we all know, I don't want to go over everything that has transpired in the last week because we are all very much aware that on Friday, January 27th, at around 4:30 in the afternoon, President Trump signed an executive order which effectively suspended the entrance into the United States of many categories of immigrants and non-immigrants. For tonight's purposes, I'm going to address my comments to the suspension of entry of refugees into our country. As it stands right now, there is a 120-day suspension of all entry into this country by refugees. There have been tiny, minor exceptions to that as people try to figure out when this order was supposed to begin and who was supposed to be actually covered under it. But essentially speaking, we are virtually shut down in terms of refugees arriving. Added to that, the arrival of Syrian refugees is indefinitely suspended. And that, I guess, is pretty critical for many of us that are standing here today, or some of you who got to sit. As the original resolution of this city council was to certainly open our arms, open our homes, our doors, to those who were fleeing the conflict from Syria. After a week, we are still trying to uncover all of the different nuances of this executive order and the long-term effects of this order. There have been many conversations between the national voluntary agencies, of which there are nine, the State Department, sort of, and our local voluntary agencies. Again, trying to figure out what this means for us. I cannot speak for the other national voluntary agencies. I can only speak to the one that we work under, which is the United States Conference of Catholic Bishops, Migration and Refugee Services. At this moment, Catholic Charities and the City of Northampton had in its pipeline to come to the City of Northampton 18 individuals. We had done assurances. Briefly, assurances are we receive a request for verification, we assure. That assurance says we are ready, able, willing, and open to accept this family, this refugee, into our town. We had done 18 of those, and those people are still in our pipeline. That is where they will remain for the next 120 days. What is in our pipeline? We have five individuals from the Democratic Republic of the Congo. We have seven individuals from Syria. We have three individuals from Iraq and three individuals from Bhutan. All of them are suspended insofar as their travel is concerned. What is this going to do to the program itself? Because there really is no assurance, if you will, that this program will reopen in 120 days. There is no real assurance that those folks that are in the pipeline will be allowed to pass the new extreme vetting procedures. What we do is we remain open. We remain to plan and we prepare. We are set and ready to receive those families if they can come. And Catholic Charities, along with its national voluntary agency, will find the funding and the resources to remain open and available and survive this so that we will be here when that 120-day, maybe 180-day, time frame is concluded. In the meantime, just a couple of little things that might be of interest. There is a category of people that enter through the refugee pipeline, and that category is SIVs. That's special immigrant visas. Those are actually given to folks from Iraq and Afghanistan who were translators or interpreters for us during the time of conflict. they are at high risk of being terminated. Therefore, they are actually allowing us to assure any that want to come to Massachusetts, and they would be allowed to move during this 120-day period. Whether or not we will receive a request is not known, but in something that looks very dark, that's a tiny glimmer of hope. Outside of that, I don't really know what else to say. We are just moving on. There is so much that is being done behind the scenes. All of the national voluntary agencies, along with their partners, are doing tremendous amount of advocacy behind the scenes. And certainly they are working with other organizations to test the legality of this executive order. What I can say is it's not going to be the last executive order that's going to affect both immigrants and refugees. We've already been given a heads up on that. So I would say remain vigilant. I would say fight like hell. We have got to make sure that we, as so many have expressed tonight, are the voice for the voiceless. The refugees are truly the voiceless. They cannot stand here tonight. They cannot tell you the incredible anguish that they will have experienced, and they will have experienced this when they find out that they were close, but it's not going to happen. That is an anguish. So fight. Use your voices, use your feet, use your letters, use your phone calls, use anything that's at your disposal to say, this is not American. I'll take any questions.
Councilor Klein.
I wonder if you could share, I think what can give us a little bit of hope as well is just the level of organizing that's gone on in the city, how many people are involved here in the city, just kind of the lay of the land of the organizing that's happened over the last 4 or 5, 6 months.
Well, actually, this is a process that's almost taken a year. I was doing the math today. And in that process, there's only one reason that we were able to actually start assuring refugees is because we were prepared. And this city was prepared. Over about 800 volunteers, 10 circles of care, and just an enormous amount of people willing to come forward to provide jobs. Housing has always been dicey, but as we got closer, so many people were just willing to say, I'm willing to rent my place. We were organized, we were ready, with just an outpouring that was crazy. The other thing that happened is over the weekend is people, regardless of the fact that they knew that this executive order had put a temporary suspension, more people started emailing and calling, looking for ways desperately to be a part of the solution, and wanting to know what it is that they could do to help with the refugee resettlement. So instead of really stopping people, it really re-galvanized them to be a part of this process. Very proud of my own staff, and so proud of the fact that we have a partner like Northampton in which to do this. And I can't even begin to think of a better one.
It's very sad, very, very sad with what has happened here. And knowing how many visits that we've had throughout the city with residents, even on my ward, and Alyssa Klein, working counselor, very, very tirelessly on this, I think it was so unfair that an executive order, nobody even knowing about it, and families thinking that they're coming into our country, how do they feel now? If it was me or my family, they would feel, well, I guess I'm not wanted. And I say, shame on our president. That's how I feel about it. I'm not talking for everybody else, but I think this is a disgrace.
Anyone else? Any?
You probably can't answer this, but if, God willing, the order is lifted in 120 days or now less than 120 days, since it's all ceased for these 120 days, what will that kind of backlog, how would that impact getting people out who should have been moving into this country in the last 4 months?
That actually is a very good question, and we're certainly looking at all of that. Since nothing was definitive, in other words, there is language that says that people can make exceptions on a case-by-case basis, but there is no procedure to do that. Our national voluntary agencies are desperately trying to find out what that procedure is, because I certainly think that, especially with the Congolese families, this would be a perfect case-by-case exception. But we can't figure that out yet because nobody has a procedure. That wasn't really thought out how that would be. I think also what is true, and that's in the executive order itself, is that once we get past the 120 days, there will be new vetting procedures in place, what is called affectionately extreme vetting. Anyone who has been through the pipeline and has already gone through vetting will have to go back through any changes and or additions that are made to that vetting. So although they're in our pipeline, which kind of preserves a kind of place for them, the problem is that we do not know what the outcome will be once all of these other procedures are in place. Added to that, something that we also are working extremely hard to change is the fact that we went from 110,000 possible refugees coming to this country to 50,000. As of the signing of the order, already 36,000 had arrived here in the United States in the first quarter and a half, which essentially leaves about 14,000 that would be left to be resettled here. That is a huge cut. The other thing that can happen with something like that is a lot of people geared up, a lot of organizations and agencies had geared up to this bigger number. Some new people had come on board. We're going to see agencies closing and having to let people go because they can't sustain this. Everything that was the any monies that are actually in these contracts only are effective while there are refugees moving. When there is not, there is no money there. So agencies are left to try to find different ways to stay open and to keep their people hired in all of this. So that's what I meant by the longer term effects. There are implications for not just those who are overseas, there are implications for those of us who are here, and there's implications into the next fiscal year.
Councilor LaBarge.
So the families that were supposed to come into our city, yes, they've been told that there's a delay on them for 120 days, maybe possibly 180 days, or who knows, it could be longer.
That's what they've been told.
So have you heard what they're feeling out there being told this? Has no. Any kind of communication come to you?
Because of the fact that a lot of this actually happens from UNHCR to the State Department, down to the national, down to the local, between the national voluntary agencies and the State Department, there's only a certain amount of biodata and sharing that goes on until the family actually gets here. So the communication is not ever between the national voluntary agency and the families. That's kind of a blocked thing. I feel, Marianne, that the way you described it is exactly what it is. There will be tremendous anguish. There will be the feeling of desperation. And having spent all of that time, and I do mean, and I want to just reemphasize, if you wouldn't mind my taking a moment, that at least for the Syrian family, if not for more of those families, it took them 24 months to get into the pipeline. All that time, all that anguish spent to be so close, but not. So yeah, we've spent an awful lot of time really in reflection and meditation on what's going on with those families.
I heard you say that we needed to speak. We needed to have a strong voice. What do you mean by that? We have tons of people who came 2 weeks ago for the wage theft resolution that we have. What can we all do with a strong voice that you need?
Well, certainly the one thing that we are recommending is that with everything that Congress gets thrown at them, and so now it's the whole new thing of the Supreme Court justice, what is today's headline news becomes tomorrow's back page news so fast. We're outraged, but then there's something else to be outraged at. There's another thing that we flag in our resolution. What I'm just asking is don't let that happen. Be as outraged today as you were yesterday. And if you've written your congresspeople, if you've written, by the way, you can write letters to the Supreme Court justices, by the way. Write everybody you know. Call. And if you did it yesterday, do it again today. If you did it last week, do it again next week. Keep abreast of what's transpiring in the legal push against this. Support where you can. Get others to support that. Scream and holler, make noise. But the minute we stop making noise is the minute we lose. And I know it's so easy. There's so many things that distract us and so many things that upset us. But keeping that alive, not because it's about things, but because it's about people. You know, 18 of whom are waiting to come here. And we were just on a roll. I mean, it would have been much more than 18. I mean, we were just beginning to do those assurances. You know, we still want our 51. And we're still committed to that. And as I said, Catholic Charities has put together the resources and the funding to stay alive in this. We'll support it ourselves.
Thank you.
Anyone else? So thank you, Catherine. Unfortunately, I think the president is going to supply us with plenty of outrage for days to come, for a term to come. I think the outrage is galvanizing. And as you described, actually, it's very difficult to keep a pace with the. It's like drinking from a fire hose and trying to figure out what you act on which item, which outrage do you address to try to concentrate your energies.
I think that's an awfully good strategy, don't you?
I think the best way to counteract a fire hose is to reverse a fire hose. So,
is to do what with it?
Turn the fire hose back.
Oh, okay. I thought you were suggesting.
No, it's all right. So, but I thank you. That's actually not consoling, but it's good to know. And your call to action does not go unheeded.
Yeah.
And I do appreciate it.
Together we can do this. I just know it.
If it's any consolation, the next item on the agenda is a resolution doing pretty much what you just asked on that.
Thank you, and thank the City Council very much.
Thank you.
Thank you. Next up is item 17.247. This is a resolution condemning President Trump's January 27, 2017 executive order, quote, protecting the nation from foreign terrorist entry into the United States. This is the first reading. And the resolution reads as follows. This is upon the recommendation of Councilor Lisa F. Klein, Councilor Gina Louise Shara, Councilor William H. Dwight, and Councilor James Nash. This is a resolution, as I said, condemning President Trump's January 27th, 2017 executive order, quote, protecting the nation from foreign terrorist entry into the United States, and whereas Northampton is a diverse and vibrant community of residents who themselves or by ancestry hail from all over the world, represent a variety of faiths, ethnicities, and races. And whereas in its December 2015 resolution calling for the welcoming of refugees in the city of Northampton, the city council affirmed its commitment to Northampton as, quote, serving as a place of sanctuary and refuge for refugees from around the world, close quote. And whereas Northampton is scheduled to receive and resettle 51 refugees in 2017, and whereas the city of Northampton is committed to maintaining its status as a sanctuary city, meaning we will not honor or enforce any detainer request from the U.S. Immigration and Customs Enforcement, otherwise known as ICE, that is non-criminal, and will continue to protect our residents from unfair targeting. And whereas on January 27, 2017, President Donald Trump issued an executive order that suspended immediately entry of all refugees to the United States for 120 days, barred Syrian refugees indefinitely, and blocked entry into the U.S. for 90 days for citizens of seven majority Muslim countries, Iran, Iraq, Libya, Somalia, Sudan, Syria, and Yemen. And whereas the executive order is being criticized as legally and constitutionally questionable and morally reprehensible by Americans of all political persuasions and faiths, and whereas President Trump's order establishes an unprecedented and unconstitutional religious test for immigration into the country, called by the American Civil Liberties Union, quote, a euphemism for discriminating against Muslims, close quote, that violates the fundamental American values of religious freedom and equality and undermines the principles of inclusion and dignity for all upon which the United States is built. And whereas disregard of federal court injunctions of executive order constitutes a violation of the separation of powers between the three branches of the federal government established under the United States Constitution, and whereas the Northampton City Council believes that those fleeing violence and persecution must be welcomed and supported in the United States, not targeted by hate. And whereas refugee and immigrant communities in the United States are now living in fear for their safety and security in this country. And whereas the Northampton City Council recognizes that is the ethical, moral, and social responsibility of every human being to uplift and protect one another. And whereas the Northampton City Council is committed to channeling the grief and outrage felt by many in the city into defending and protecting refugees and immigrants, challenging the dangerous policy proposals of the Trump administration, and working to build a United States and a community that is welcoming and accepting of all people. Now, therefore, be it resolved that the City Council of Northampton, Massachusetts stands in solidarity with refugees and immigrants and in opposition to President Donald Trump's January 27, 2017 executive order protecting the nation and from foreign terrorist entry into the United States, and calls upon the President to rescind the order immediately. And be it further resolved that the City Council of Northampton believes in this nation's founding principle of religious freedom, refuses to ban people for their faith, and believes that we are a city and a nation made stronger when we welcome all people. And be it further resolved, the City Council of Northampton remains committed to the city's status as a sanctuary city. And be it further resolved that the City Council of Northampton, Massachusetts remains committed to accepting refugees and immigrants despite the executive order. And be it further resolved that the City Council of Northampton, Massachusetts stands in solidarity with our Massachusetts Senators Ed Markey and Elizabeth Warren and our State Attorney General Maura Healey, who tweeted respectively as, quote, as war forces millions from their homeland, U.S. should welcome more refugees, not less. I will fight at real Donald Trump's immoral Muslim ban. That's Ed Markey. Elizabeth Warren tweeted, we will not allow a Muslim ban in the United States of America. And we condemn Donald Trump's unconstitutional, un-American, unlawful executive order, hashtag no ban, no wall. And that's Maura Healey, and calls upon all of our elected officials in Massachusetts and beyond to do everything in their power to ensure that the executive order is rescinded. And be it further resolved that the City Council of Northampton, Massachusetts calls upon the residents of Northampton to be guided by their consciences to resist this executive order and any others which they deem to be illegal or unethical. Be it further resolved that the Northampton City Council will abide by and defend with all the resources available to their office the principles and mandates of the Constitution, including religious freedom. And be it further resolved, the administrative assistant to the city council shall cause a copy of this resolution to be sent to the U.S. President Donald Trump, U.S. Senators Elizabeth Warren and Ed Markey, U.S. Representatives Richard Neal and Jim McGovern, Massachusetts Governor Charles Baker, Massachusetts Attorney General Maura Healey, Massachusetts Senate President Stanley Rosenberg, and Massachusetts State Representative Peter Kokot, and the Northampton, Massachusetts Mayor David J. Narkowitz. I'll accept a motion.
I accept it.
Discussion?
I do.
Council LaBarge, did you want to say something?
Surely. I would like to say what my feelings are about this resolution. I will definitely support this, definitely. And I also knew that councilors would not sit back and not do a resolution. Yes, President Donald Trump on January 27th issued an executive order without notice, no notice, suspended immediately entry of all refugees to the United States. This order discriminates on basis of religion and national origin, and there's no question about that. It denies residents access to due process and equal protection, and this order violates federal immigration law, and it's unconstitutional. This ban also violates many First, 10th, and 14th Amendment rights. This ban is unbelievable. I also feel that equal protection, regardless of religion, and a due process under this law. Just watching the news, which occurred on the airports, affected by this executive order, showed many children being placed in such fear. Their parents, their grandmother, their grandfathers, brothers and sisters. This is not the America that I live in. And to see children with the expression of fear, they will remember this for the rest of their lives. People with green cards were detained and questioned. Why? Why? Northampton, which I am proud to be a native of this city, born and raised, and it is a sanctuary city. And I am proud, as a city councilor, that this has happened. We open our doors to refugees. We welcome them and their families. Our city of Northampton, our mayor and city council, and our police chief, Jody Casper, and men and women of our police department will make sure all who comes to our city will be treated respect and dignity. They will not be unfair. We are with you, and we will voice for you, and we will be safe. We are a diverse community. And I mean that from my heart. I am so upset with what has occurred here with our president-elect and his cabinet putting this executive order in, which is just inhuman, and I don't want to go any further because I'm so upset with this.
Councilor O'Donnell, Councilor Bidwell, Councilor Shara.
I'd like to suggest an amendment that I hope reflects what my basic feelings are about this. I'm not sure which paragraph it is. It's the one that begins, whereas, well, I'll read it, it's short. Whereas the executive order is being criticized as legally and constitutionally questionable and morally reprehensible by persuasion. My motion would be to simplify it. It should say, whereas the executive order is unconstitutional and is morally reprehensible, period. Or semicolon, but you know. That's my motion. And I
Councilor Klein, Councilor Nash, Councilor Shara, you accept that as a friendly amendment?
Okay. Can I actually?
You got more?
Well, no, I mean.
Oh, okay.
Well, actually I do, but I mean, just on that point, I mean, in a way, I mean, I appreciate that this was brought forward, and I'm thankful to all the sponsors who did it. In a way, it almost says it's almost too polite, because we're actually talking about an executive philosophy of unlimited presidential authority, and it's not just this executive order. It's others that have come at a fast clip, and I think that's what, in addition to just the moral reprehensibleness of it, that's what's really disturbing, is the disregard for our democracy. So, just like to say that.
Councilor Bidwell, you were next, and then Councilor Shara.
I appreciate very much the leadership shown by Councilors Klein and Shara and Dwight and Nash. I'm sure some of us will be hearing from friends and neighbors saying, yet another council resolution, but these things do matter. It really is critical that we be on record, that we align with other communities around the country doing similar motions, and that we find solidarity with one another in motions like this. I wanted to read just a few sentences from, it was an op-ed piece in the Times from David Miliband, president and chief executive of the International Rescue Committee, and he's former British Foreign Secretary. President Trump's executive order is a repudiation of fundamental American values, an abandonment of the United States' role as a humanitarian leader, and, far from protecting the country from extremism, a propaganda gift to those who would plot harm to America. And then he quotes the Cato Institute, not normally a source of statistics and analysis that I would cite, but it's appropriate here. According to the Cato Institute, the chances that a citizen here will be killed by a refugee are 1 in 3.64 billion a year. An American is far, far more likely to be killed by lightning than by a terrorist attack carried out by a refugee. Support for refugees is not charity. It's a contribution to the global stability on which all nations depend, and this is especially important at a time when the world faces a heightened threat of terrorism. And it concludes, the world looks to America for enlightened leadership. Its citizens seek the same from their government. Refugee policy is a telling test for every nation. The United States passed that test for so many years, so it's a tragedy for it now to fail when its commitment is needed more than ever. That's all I have to say.
Councilor Shara.
First, I want to thank Councilor Klein, who did a tremendous amount of work on this, and my other councilors for this. It's going to be hard to find words amidst the anger and sadness that I feel, but not only is this bad, stupid, unconstitutional policy, it's cruel, and as Councilor LaBarge said, inhumane. These are people, and these are no longer abstract people that we had the will and desire to help and have been talking about, as Catherine said, for almost a year. Now these are individuals who've been contracted to come and be our neighbors, and they've been given a lifeline to come here, and some of them, 10 of them, just as recently as Friday, were handed that lifeline, and it was severed that very same day. And what Catherine didn't mention is, you know, we do know somewhat about them. There were 10 people on Friday. 5 of those are children. The oldest being 8, the youngest being, I think, 9 months old. And, you know, the 8-year-old would be entering the Northampton Public Schools with my daughter, who will be 8 this year. The middle one, or the third in line, would be entering kindergarten with another one of my daughters in the fall. And I just wanted to, not to make it about me, but just to giving that context of that not only would they be here living with us, these would be my children's classmates. These would be our neighbors. These are people that we desperately want to have come be in our community. It's just unbelievably heartbreaking for me and should be for everyone, and should underscore just the unbelievable shame that should be felt by the administration. And so things are feel very much out of control, and they feel out of our control. But as I think was said many times tonight in different ways, you know, anything that we can do to speak out against this hateful, discriminatory, life-threatening act that's been done by the administration, we have an absolute moral obligation to do. And I thank you all for being here to listen to it.
Councilor Klein?
Now that you've broken the barrier of crying, I was thinking that I wouldn't say anything because I am extraordinarily upset about this and really felt like I could barely get words out to kind of endorse this resolution that we wrote and are putting forward here. So I just wanted to talk about others other than the refugees. Thank you, Council Sheriff, for talking about the refugees that were supposed to be coming to Northampton. There are two stories that I know of personally of folks who haven't been able to return to be reunited with their families. We have someone named Basilius Zeno, who is a UMass graduate student who's been very involved in the refugee project here in Northampton. He's Syrian, his brother is Syrian, his sister-in-law and brand new nephew live in California. His brother has not met his son. He couldn't get out of Syria. He finally got to Turkey, and he literally, the day that the ban was enforced, was told as a Syrian that indefinitely he was not going to be able to come to the United States. So his wife and infant son, who he's never met, are, you know, waiting for him to come the next day, and he was banned from coming indefinitely. I have a friend in Nashville who has a very close Somali friend who is taking care of her two nieces because their father was sick in Somalia, and she, the sister went home to take care of the father while her two children were in the care of her sister, who lives in Nashville. And she now can't get back into the United States to be reunited with her family. She was supposed to return next week, and she is also banned indefinitely. And so her two daughters are now going to be raised by her sister. So these are just stories that I know of personally. There are so many more that are happening. So this is about people's lives. And it's really unthinkable, I think, to a lot of us in Northampton that we would be separated indefinitely from our children, from our parents, from our sisters and brothers. But this is really the reality of what this this travel ban, this Muslim ban, does. You know, I just want to reiterate something that we've said a number of times here on the council floor, especially around getting the refugee resolution passed and just talking about the refugee project here in Northampton. This is a country of refugees and immigrants, and many of us have to look back just one generation to recognize that, you know, our immediate ancestors were refugees, were immigrants. Some have to look back two or three generations, but essentially this country is founded on people who have come from other places. Unless you're Native American, unless you are of African ancestry and your ancestors were brought here as slaves, essentially you are here because your parents and grandparents were refugees or immigrants, coming from economic hardship, coming from war. So all this to say, at the very least, we have a moral responsibility. We have a responsibility to welcome folks who are refugees and immigrants and offer them safety and so much more than safety. You know, what's also interesting is that Donald Trump's family were immigrants to this country from Germany. He has a portion of his family that are Jewish that were refugees from the Holocaust.
So the absolute blindness of not accepting refugees and immigrants into this country on his part, when he himself comes from immigrants and refugees, is connected to a portion of his family that were refugees, is just mind-boggling. I want to say something that I think we all know, but it needs to be said. Refugees are so extraordinarily vetted before they come to this country, especially refugees from Muslim-majority countries. This ban is racist type, essentially. And as we said in the resolution, and as Councillor O'Donnell kind of brought home, it's illegal, it's unconstitutional, and it is immoral. For the folks in the community who say that the city council shouldn't spend time on federal policy, I just want to say that now is the time more than ever that we do. We have to be vigilant, and we have a responsibility as a city council, as a community, to be speaking out. We need to send a really clear message to our state legislators, to our federal legislators. We need to be able to amplify our voice through them, that we have to do everything in our power to stand up against the unethical, unconstitutional, and illegal things that are coming out of the current presidential administration. And I think that's all I'm going to say. Thank you for bearing with me, because I know that I shared a lot of things that we as a community talk about all the time, but I think it's really important that we as a city council kind of hear them, voice them, and act on them. Thanks.
I just want to thank to be invited to be one of the co-sponsors. I received the invitation Saturday after reading the headlines. These days, I opened the paper up for about 15 minutes. There was a time where I could spend most of the morning reading the paper, and to see the photographs, to read the reactions, to see the mayhem, and to it's an honor to be part of this, so thank you.
And
you want to bring your Scrivener's error?
No, Scrivener's errors.
Oh yeah, the hail
is spelled it correctly. Yes, it's H-A-I-L. So hale and hearty is what our voices should be as we express this. This is essentially an expression of shame, and a shame borne by all of us, mind you, not just counselors and other people. We are not participants, and we did not create this situation, but we certainly, if we are silent, we are complicit. And it is our intent, given with our limited powers, by the way, we are no more powerful than most of the people in this audience insofar as making laws. We can stop you from parking illegally. We can't, but that's pretty limited. So the power, this is an expression, as I said, of shame, because this is a dark shame. Whether we like it or not, the president speaks for us. He was duly elected. He speaks for us. He represents us. And it is our responsibility to call him out and address inequities, crimes, and cruelty as we see them. And to not say anything. That would be a deeper shame. So, any other comment or discussion on this? Roll call, please.
Councillor Dwight.
Yes.
Councillor Klein.
Yes.
Councillor LaBarge.
Yes.
Councillor Murphy.
Yes.
Councillor Nash.
Yes.
Councillor O'Donnell.
Yes.
Councillor Sherrill.
Yes.
Councillor Griswold.
Yes.
Councillor Carney.
Yes.
And that passes in first reading. There'll be another reading of this on February. What's the date of the next meeting? 16th.
Mr. President.
It's after Valentine's Day. Groundhog Day.
Mr. President.
I'd like to move to suspend rules. I think we should have two readings tonight. And if there's a second, I would explain why.
Okay, so motion and a second.
My argument is that because this is a statement that is timely, I mean, it does qualify for emergency status, if you will. I mean, the order was issued on January 27th, Friday, at 4:42 p.m. After that, U.S. district judges from Brooklyn, Massachusetts, Washington State, Virginia, California came in, and they issued temporary blocks. And they couldn't wait to do that while people were being deported and detained as part of this illegal instant regime that had been created. And while the rights were being trampled upon, while the Establishment Clause of the First Amendment was being trampled upon. Subsequently, attorney generals from 15 states, including Massachusetts, declared in a letter that this order was unconstitutional, un-American, and unlawful, and they did not wait to do that. So equally, we shouldn't wait to do that. I don't normally like to suspend the rule because it's important to have public comment, but it's insofar as this resolution has value in joining with others and making the statement, it is value now, not more so than 2 weeks from now. So we should vote on it tonight.
Any other discussion on a suspension of rules? Suspension of rules. This is on suspension of rules. Councilor Nash.
I think this is a great idea. We can't tweet, but we can do two readings tonight.
Yes. Councilor LaBarge, this is on suspension of rules. Well, I got that. Got it. Anyone? Okay, all those in favor of suspending the rules to allow for a second reading, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Any abstentions? I'll accept a motion.
Second reading.
Motions are made and seconded to put it back on the floor for second reading. Any discussion in second reading? Councilor Klein.
Well, I was going to save something that I wanted to say for the second reading, so I'm going to say it now. And that is that I think something that I didn't say in the first reading is that, you know, we create, the United States is responsible for so many of the reasons why there is such a huge refugee and immigrant population throughout the world. And the very least that we can do, I mean, it's so shocking that we're accepting 50,000 refugees, and it's, you know, that's the number that's been brought down from 110, which is the largest number of refugees this country has ever accepted by presidential mandate, I should say. And it's the absolute tiniest way in which we can take some responsibility for the refugees and the immigrants that we have created throughout the world with our wars that we've waged, the economic manipulations that we have imposed upon other countries, foreign countries, the policy machinations that the United States has carried out. And so it's extraordinary to me that we are now not even taking that tiniest bit of responsibility with this travel ban, with this Muslim ban.
Any other comments in second reading? Roll call, please.
Councilor Klein.
Yes.
Councilor LaBarge.
Yes.
Councilor Murphy.
Yes.
Councilor Nash.
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell.
Yes.
Councilor Sherrod.
Yes.
Councilor Goodwin.
Yes.
Councilor Carney.
Yes.
Councilor Boyd.
Yes. That passes in second reading. All right. So we're back to the agenda, and for a buzzkill, we're going to do recognition and one-minute announcements by counselors. Anyone have any announcements? Councilor Bidwell.
Totally different subject, obviously, but I just wanted to call your attention to a session sponsored by Northampton Neighbors, the emerging group promoting the aging in place issue here in Northampton. Dr. Atul Gawande, world-renowned author, author of Being Mortal, will take part in a video simulcast that will
Do you want to hold on a second? We'll let that.
Yeah.
So if I could ask you, if you have conversations, could you please carry them on out in the hall so we can continue? Thank you. Councilor Goodwell, you have the floor.
At the Northampton Senior Center, Monday, February 13th at 4:30, I will be a video cast of Atul Gawande talking about the changing experience of aging and the whole aging in place phenomenon, and particularly it'll relate to this group that's organizing around those issues right here in Northampton.
Anyone else? 1 minute announcements?
Yes.
Councilor LaBarge?
Yes, I'd like to announce that the previous meetings that we had scheduled at Ryan Road School, because of inclement weather and the school's canceling their activities at 4 o'clock, we could not have our meeting at Ryan Road School. On the 115 acres preserving conservation, and also the very small development being put in place on Pertzbert Road of 8 houses. That will be scheduled, and it is at Ryan Road School, February 6th at 6 o'clock p.m. in the gymnasium. Also, if it's inclement weather and the school closes, it is scheduled for February 8th. Same time, same place.
Any other announcements? Okay. So, Councilor Sheriff, you can gather yourself together.
Oh, wow, really?
We have, we move on to item A under presentations. This is a committee study request. The Committee on Community Resources is giving its final report on the study of Northampton's downtown economy. And Councilor Sherry, you have the floor.
May I request a quick recess so we can set this up?
Yeah.
It's 9 o'clock.
Recess? 8.5 minutes? 8.75 minutes?
3/4, yeah.
Okay. 8.75 minutes we're recessed. All right, we're coming out of recess, and next up is the final report to the Northampton City Council on the committee study request on the local economy. Council Shara has the floor and the PowerPoint.
You all could have had a very quick spiel from me last meeting, but since you made me wait, you now have a PowerPoint presentation. So this is our final report to the council on the committee's study request on the local economy from the City Council Committee on Community Resources. The date on here is January 12th because that is the day that we submitted the report, but as I've noted, you pushed me off till today. So February 2nd. I also want to note that this PowerPoint presentation is in honor of Councilor O'Donnell's birthday because he loves PowerPoint presentations.
Thank you.
I want to thank the vice chair of the committee, Councilor Bidwell, who was the main author of this report and did a ton of work to bring it all together, and worked over the summer with Jonathan Goldman, who was our intern for the summer and has just done a tremendous amount of work on the study. I want to thank the other councilors, Councilor Klein and Councilor Carney, for all the work that they did in the committee on the study. And we've seen tonight a lot of the work that they did outside of the committee, but still that was a result or a part of information that was received during the study with their resolution and order. And I want to thank Pam because she helped me so much and through this whole process. She helped consolidating information and all the way through, created a web page for the study, which I thought was really important so that the public could follow along with what we were doing and be able to have everything, all the information that we were receiving in one place. And she helped us navigate this committee study request, which is the very first one. So just to review what the request was, March 2016, so almost a year ago, the council president and vice president issued a committee study request, the very first, to the Community Resources Committee to, quote, study issues relative to the local economy with a focus on businesses and workers in downtown Northampton and downtown Florence for the purpose of identifying practical recommendations, if any, that the city council could pursue to strengthen the local economy. To briefly review the process that we went through, we had a series of meetings to structure the study and schedule forum starting on March 8th. We received reports from three sources on March 21st from Suzanne Beck, from the Chamber, from the Pioneer Valley Workers Center and the UMass Labor Center, and from Terry Masterson, the City Economic Development Director. As I said, Pam created a web page for the CSR for easy public access. We met with Wayne Fiden of Planning and Sustainability on May 3rd. Between May and July, we held four public forums, and we submitted a preliminary report to the council on August 10th and began deliberation on September 19th and submitted our final report to the council on January 12th and are discussing it tonight. A little bit more on the public forums, which were talked about a little bit at the last meeting. We had four forums that were centered around different constituencies, but were open to anyone. Anyone who wished to come and speak on the downtown economy could come to any of the four forums. We did extensive outreach to various stakeholders, either through direct contact by email or calling, visiting businesses, flyers, or contacting organizations who we felt could reach out to, in particular, workers who might not know about the forums otherwise. And so the four forums we had were on May 16th. We had one geared towards business owners and received testimony from 16 people there. June 20th, there was one for downtown residents and downtown workers and heard testimony from 18 people. June 27th, there was one also geared towards downtown workers. This one was at 1 o'clock in the afternoon, which we scheduled so that workers who work in the evenings would hopefully be able to attend a forum. And the last one was July 18th for property owners and to talk about leasing, arts, and tourism. And we heard from 10 people there. And these are the two flyers. This is the flyer that Pam created, and we also had it translated into Spanish and tried to get it out into the community. We heard from many, many people, as you saw, on a myriad of topics. And in our deliberation, we're able to take all of that data and consolidate it into five categories on which we are submitting recommendations. The first one is on the arts, downtown events, promotion, and tourism. And the next is at-risk downtown populations. Third is workers' issues. Fourth is the overall state of the downtown economy. And the last is transportation and parking issues. That is my only animation in this PowerPoint, I'm just gonna tell you. So the first one, arts, downtown events, promotion, and tourism. We heard from many people about the array of wonderful resources and organizations and arts groups that we have in Northampton, and we would like to acknowledge, and others did too, that the city has an arts and culture department and an arts council, which is not something that every municipality has. So we already contribute resources towards the arts. We heard that people were interested in better promotion of events, development of a year-round market, greater visibility on travel websites and outside marketing of Northampton for tourism. People would like more festivals and annual events downtown and more pop-up art or opportunities for transitional art downtown. So based on this, our recommendation is that recognizing that the city and various nonprofit arts organizations already provide a broad range of exciting and well-promoted events and are already addressing many of the issues cited, the committee recommends that, with the cooperation of the mayor, the committee join with the other groups to host a one-time forum on the topics of downtown arts, events promotion, and how city government can potentially play an enhanced role in these realms. We would propose that a small working group, including one of our committee members, organize a forum designed to include all arts-related organizations and organizations involved in downtown events planning and promotion. Possible forum topics are a report from the Regional Tourism Council, discussion on downtown marketing strategies and exploration of possible revenue streams for marketing, updates on planned Northampton downtown arts and events programming, updates on programming and events for Florence Center, coordinating the activities of all groups and their promotion, maybe with a master calendar, outreach for volunteers for things like events or for board vacancies, soliciting support of the media in events promotion and volunteer recruitment, and how the city council and other city offices, committees, and commissions can be of additional help. So moving on to the next group, which is at-risk downtown populations. We heard from a broad range of downtown stakeholders at every single meeting and during the forums on this topic of at-risk and marginalized downtown people. Many comments were centered on the needs of individuals and how to help and better channel resources. Other comments were directed towards the perceived issues around actions, particularly solicitation for money. As a committee, we spent a lot of time talking about this and having, I think, a thoughtful conversation. This next statement, I think, was important for us and reflects how we as a committee felt about this topic. So I'm going to read it. Quote, "The complexity of this issue and the extreme sensitivity required to address it was made clear. As a committee, we are committed to the constitutionally protected rights of all people in public space and recognize the contributions of all to the fabric and vibrancy of our community. We also recognize that this is an issue and frustration for some. We recognize the impact the opioid crisis is having on the at-risk community and how potential cuts to social services and federal and state funding may expand that community. So based on that, our recommendation is, quote, the committee recommends that the mayor convene a task force. Is everyone else's flipping like that? Okay. Convene a task force of city employees, representatives from social service, housing, and advocacy organizations, downtown stakeholders, and a member of this committee to explore non-ordinance and non-punitive ways of addressing the needs of downtown at-risk populations in ways that expanded resources can be directed towards the agencies and organizations doing direct work with our at-risk populations. Possible topics for that task force could be coordinating services to these populations, additional resources for social service outreach professionals to increase their current work, doing one-on-one work connecting with people downtown, finding effective ways to facilitate contributions to agencies and organizations providing services, either through effective messaging, use of new technologies, or alternative donation locations, and what the city council and other city offices and committees and commissions can do to be of additional help. The third topic is workers' issues. I'm not going to spend a lot of time on that because you'll see that our recommendation came to fruition tonight. But you know, we heard from many, many workers and advocates for workers and labor representatives, many of whom were here this evening, about working conditions facing some restaurant workers and some construction workers and other workers. We also heard concerns from business owners about painting all employers, especially restaurant owners, with the same negative brush. Our recommendation, as I said, it happened tonight, which was that the draft executive order being prepared by the mayor and a proposed council resolution and order be brought to the council. And additionally, our committee has expressed interest in supporting possible resolutions of state legislation aimed at strengthening the Attorney General's ability to enforce worker condition and wage-related statutes. Next topic is overall state of the downtown economy. We heard a lot of commentary from people expressing concerns about the general state of the economy downtown. We also received presentations and testimony from city departments and realtors and other people with perspectives on this and who gave us various points of data as well. Things we heard were concerns about retail vacancies and high rents on Main Street, effects of e-retail and the casino, People were appreciative of the council's committed support to the single tax rate, and we heard praise for the generous support that nonprofits receive from the downtown businesses, though they do often feel stretched because they feel like they're asked a lot. And there was appreciation for the city's investment in the downtown improvements at the Academy and Pulaski Park. So our recommendation for this is a little bit different. It, you know, we heard a lot about things that we don't have control over, and such as rents or the casino. But it doesn't mean that we can't express opinions about them. So our recommendation is that we communicate our views on the economy in one or two opinion pieces to appear likely in the Gazette or the Republican. So possible topics for those pieces are info from the previous and the upcoming downtown economic indicators report from the economic development director about occupancy rates, public and private investment, hotel, motel, and meals tax trends, and support of our continued support of the single tax rate. This next one has already gotten some love from Mass Live, so you'll enjoy that. The fact that Northampton is, quote, the downtown is the envy of almost all other cities our size. While I think the committee would be happy to toot Northampton's horn, this is actually something that we heard from multiple people that weren't just us, from realtors and from Wayne Fiden, and people whose job it is to do comparisons of other communities and spend time in other communities. So I think that we stand by that statement. Another topics are impacts of the casino and online commerce, innovative ways of encouraging shop local, support for the new DNA, encouragement to landlords to show restraint regarding rents and not overinflate the market. Obviously, we can't control that, but it never hurts to ask. A recognition that the majority of restaurants play by the rules and are worthy of patronage. Encouraging more businesses to validate for the parking garage. I think last I checked, we're still at just one. Is that right? Yeah. So shout out to Beehive Sewing for that. And the importance of pressing for the long-awaited commuter rail service. And perhaps at the appropriate time, we would consider a resolution supporting measures to further strengthen our already strong and resilient downtown. The next one are, next category are things that really were made sense to recommend to the Transportation and Parking Commission. So they are things like, again, getting an update about the commuter rail, reviewing the loading zone ordinance, reviewing the parking ticket appeals process, and exploring whether the council should seek a seat on the PVTA board. And that is it. So, we just wanted to note that although this report completes the CSR, finally, we look forward to staying involved in these issues, and we will be happy to make further recommendations in the months ahead if we see necessary to continue drawing attention to the need for a vibrant and healthy downtown Northampton and Florence center economy. So that's my presentation.
I've said it before, I'm going to say it again. I'm extremely grateful for the energy and work and toil and strife, actually, that you guys endured in this process. We knew going in that it was going to be provocative. It was going, I had some people counsel me by saying, don't do this. It's like hitting a hornet's nest with a stick. And whereas I think, and I'm not going to speak for Councilor O'Donnell, but he and I had discussed this, and we felt that the best way to address and to amalgamate what all the concerns are and to address them is to hear them and to have the community conversation the ensuing conversation, which at times was difficult, and it did have competing interests. And I mean, that's what we do. We navigate things issues of competing interests and try to reconcile and make it work for the best for the city at whole. So what you guys did in those circumstances, and unprecedented because we never really had anything like this before, so you were starting from with no particular clear guidelines other than our very succinct letter, performed a miracle. So I'm very grateful. And I'm going to apologize one more time that we did this. So.
Can I just say one more quick thing? I wanted to thank the mayor, to whom we've respectfully already submitted this report. And I thank him for his consideration for the pieces that involve his office and other city departments. So that's one last thing.
Councilor O'Donnell, you want to speak to this?
Yeah, I echo much of what the council president said and express my how much I'm impressed by the work of the committee and Councilor Shara and Bidwell and Carney and Klein. Because in a sense, the subject matter was impossible. It's so complex. You're talking about an enormously complicated ecosystem that's the local economy. And I think that's why there are no clear answers that any community could adopt that would cause us to think, there, we've done it. We've done enough for the local economy. Instead, the results of the study prove the point that it's an ongoing process. And that's why I think the recommendations call for further discussion about specific ideas, which is enormously valuable, I think, because it sort of makes it part of our ongoing thought process. So it's not just a one-time thing that we've done, or that this committee has done very well. I think it's, just made us think about how all these elements must be addressed in the course of our normal work as a city council. And of course, we have to be very concerned with the state of the local economy. So I think it's for that reason that I think this has been a success. And thank you again to the committee for doing it.
So this will come up again in finance, and the finance committee, you're doing only insofar as you're taking a non-committal poll, basically, of acceptance of it. We don't have a formal acceptance process. Councilor O'Donnell and I basically made the request, and I'll speak for him in this respect. We accept your report, and once again, as we said, and we're grateful. So, but don't worry. There's nothing else that's coming. There's no dangling threads. You're fine.
I just want to ask if the other councilors have anything that they wanted to add.
Any of the committee members?
I just add a couple of things. One is, I was greatly appreciative of Councilor Shara's leadership. We were making this up as we were going along, literally minute to minute, committee meeting by committee meeting sometimes. And so finding a way through this, it was a hornet's nest. It felt very much like a hornet's nest that was handed to us. Thank you very much. But
no problem.
Yeah. But it was incredibly valuable to just hear the very, very wide range of opinion on so many different issues that all bear one way or another on the downtown economy. Your reference to this being ongoing reminded me that the recommendation that I've been asked the most about was this recommendation that the mayor convene a task force on the at-risk downtown population and so-called panhandling issue. And I just wanted to emphasize a couple of things about that, because it at least from what I've heard, it's getting some attention and some concern. We are totally clear as a committee that, and it's why we went out of our way to put in the recommendation that you heard, that we want this task force to explore non-ordinance, as in non-regulatory, nobody going anywhere near an ordinance on this issue. We are hoping there would be an exploration of a variety of innovative and voluntary ways of dealing with the range of issues. And we also, despite the references to ongoing, we would imagine, if the mayor accepts our recommendation to create some sort of task force or advisory group, whatever, that it be very much a working group, and we're not suggesting the creation of some new body that just goes on and on. We're looking for we're hoping that there will be a relatively short-term working group addressing this issue and producing recommendations. So I just wanted to address that because I've gotten questions about that.
Any other comments on the report?
I'll just say that it was an extremely helpful, useful process, as the councilors have already said, especially the forums, and then our own working through how would we deliver this report, put it all together into a package. And I thank Councilor Scherer especially for really keeping the ship afloat and making this process work.
Thanks. Councilor Barr.
Yes, I want to thank Councilor Gina Louis Scherer and the committee for doing such a great job. Councilor Scherer, I had visited my very dear friend on Main Street who owns Happy Valleys, and she asked me if at some point could you stop in to go see her. She would like to talk to you about that issue.
Sure. Happy to.
That's Clay.
I just want to add my thanks as well. First of all, to the mayor for making his staff available. We got really important information from Terry Masterson, from Wayne Fiden. So that was a huge contribution to our understanding some of the more complex issues that downtown is facing. And a lot of thanks to Councilor Bidwell for drafting the initial draft of the report, and Councilor Scherer for all that you did to shape that. And I think all of us did a lot to really create a comprehensive report. But the thing that I wanted to kind of highlight is it was a really complex task, because what it did was, I mean, there was a lot of information, a lot of feedback from community members with a lot of different viewpoints, so that it really behooved us as counselors to really dive deep philosophically and socially and politically into some very thorny issues. And I think we did it with a lot of respect for one another and came up with some really solid ways of thinking about these thorny issues. And I really appreciate that. We didn't always agree, and we had to work through some of our philosophical and social kind of analysis and political differences. And I think we did it well. And I just want to say, because there has been a little bit of question about this issue, we did get people coming in talking about panhandling as an issue downtown. And we had very long conversations as a committee about how we wanted to kind of grapple with that question. And we unanimously as a committee decided that we wanted to talk about people who are at risk. So that can include people who are homeless, people who are living on the streets, people who are using drugs and doing it in the streets, living on the streets. And then people who ask for money on the streets. It's all part of this bigger picture of who is at risk for being abused, at risk for overdose, at risk for increased homelessness, illness, all kinds of things. And so we very deliberately decided that we weren't reacting to behaviors that people resort to when they're in distress in some way, that we are acknowledging the distress and we're looking at ways that we can help to provide resources and care for people who are in distress in some way. And not all of those people might define themselves as people in distress, and that we would respect that as well. So I just wanted to, that was one of, I think, the workers' piece and wage theft were was the other piece that was particularly kind of thorny and complicated. But
our decision to really address not the panhandling behavior per se, but people who are in some way at risk was a very deliberate decision of this committee, and I think it's really important that we emphasize that, and that as we move forward, we continue to think about it and frame it in that way.
Anyone else? Okay. Thank you, actually. I appreciate that perspective and agree with it. So, next up, the consent agenda. In the consent agenda, we have item 16.205. That's to approve the poll petition request from Verizon relocate a pole on Rust Avenue. It also includes item 17.246 is to refer to various committee appointments for the Committee on City Services, and that's the Council on Aging, Deborah Epstein of 168 Maple Ridge Road in Florence. Term to begin January 2017 to expire June 2020, and she's replacing the unexpired term of Margaret LaSalle. Also, the Historic Commission, we have Pauline Fogle of 16 Forbes Avenue in Northampton, the term beginning September 2016, expiring June 2019, and that's a reappointment. And also the minutes of January 19, 2017. I'll accept a motion.
Second.
All those in favor of the consent agenda, please say aye.
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 Any opposed? Okay. Now, we're going to recess for finance, and Council Murphy takes the chair.
And express finance. Would you call our roll, please?
Council Murphy.
Here.
Council Carney.
Present.
Council LaBarge.
Present.
Council
Here. Excellent. Motion to approve the minutes of January 19th, 2017.
Move to approve.
Second.
Any additions or corrections? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Okay, financial orders. This is upon the recommendation of the mayor. In accordance with Mass General Law 44, Section 53F and 3/4, how's that for a good one? The City of Northampton hereby accepts the provision of Section 53F and 3/4, establishing a separate revenue account to be known as the PEG Access and Cable Related Fund, into which shall be deposited funds received in connection with the 10-year cable television renewal license commencing as of April 4th, 2016, with the funding beginning in FY17. We have a motion, finance?
Make a motion.
Second.
Second. And the mayor's here to talk to us about that.
So this is actually in response to a guidelines that were issued by the Department of Revenue. And the guideline release was cable television, public educational and governmental access special revenue funds. And it basically was a guideline about how cities and towns should treat these in terms of for accounting purposes. Gave us two options. Creating an enterprise fund, which is a bit of an overkill in this case, since it's not a city-run network, or creating the 53 F and a half, who knew letters could have halves, creating the mechanism that we're proposing that you set up, which basically means that it's a place that we'll put those revenues, and then when we want to spend them, we will obviously come to the City Council to appropriate them. So it's sort of a landing zone for revenues, and of course our new contract, which will begin receiving those revenues in April of 2017 under the new contract. So we want to have this fund set up in place. The name of this fund is dictated to us, you know, verbatim. So, you know, save your amendments or, you know,
it is what it is.
Grammar corrections or whatever, that's exactly the title of it that we're supposed to call it. So we're basically asking you to accept the law to create this fund so that we'll have it in place for April.
Questions for the mayor about 53 after the report? Hearing none. Positive recommendation, finance, please say aye.
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 Opposed? All right, now we have to fix something from an old CPA order. On the recommendation of the Community Preservation Committee, the order is 17248, in order to rescind a previously approved council order due to an error with the documentation. Order that whereas the City Council order dated September 18, 2014 stated that $300,000 would be appropriated from the Community Preservation Act funding to the Valley Community Development Corporation for the Lumberyard Affordable Housing Project for the creation of 60 affordable housing units. That reference to the number of housing units was incorrect, but was provided correctly elsewhere in the order. So, given that, now therefore it be ordered that the $159,000 appropriated from the CPA Affordable Housing Reserve and the $141,000 appropriated from the CPA Budget Reserve to the Valley Community Development Corporation for the Lumberyard Affordable Project via the December 18, 2014 order is rescinded. Do we have a motion on this?
Make a motion.
And a
second.
Okay. So Sarah LaValle couldn't be here tonight. She had a family issue, but all throughout this process of these orders making their way through the council, it wasn't until recently that Attorney Seawald was preparing the affordable housing restriction legal documents that it was noted that there was a discrepancy between the body of the email and then the actual, ordered that clause, and the number 55 got turned into 60. Sarah thinks she may have been thinking about 60% of median income or whatever, but nobody caught it. It went through CPC, it went through, nobody caught it, but of course the lawyers catch everything. And so in order to file these documents and to have this affordable housing restriction match the order, we need to have you basically rescind the original one and correct this typographical error. That's why we're asking you to do this. So we're not taking any money away from anyone.
Yes, and fear not, the next order.
The next order will
is correct.
We'll correct do it again. It, yes.
And I had a conversation with the city solicitor, and there were a few options, but we felt that this was too big to qualify as a Scrivener's error. And just to make sure, given the fact that the critical nature of this particular order, we wanted to do it dead right. So that's why the rescission. Yes, I think is the term. So,
any other questions for the mayor? And we have our order. We have our motions. So, any more questions? Hearing none. All in favor of a positive
aye.
Recommendation
aye.
In finance? Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed?
The only other note, of course, is that we're requesting two readings
of
in the full
in
council
the full
meeting
council.
To correct it.
Because all right, and
get that legal filing done. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And now we have 17249, an order to revise the order to appropriate CPC funds for the Lumberyard Affordable Housing Project. Order that whereas the Valley Community Development Corporation submitted an application for Community Preservation Act funding for the Northampton Lumberyard Affordable Housing Project, and whereas the project will provide 55 of the affordable rental housing units. The units will be a mix of 1, 2, and 3 bedroom apartments, entirely restricted to households earning 60% or less of median area income. And whereas suitable affordability housing of this type is in demand locally and regionally, and whereas the Valley Community Development Corporation has an excellent record of creating affordable housing, and whereas the Valley Community Development shall hold at least one public meeting advertised at least 15 days in advance, in addition to required city hearings to receive public input on design of the project, and whereas on December 3rd, 2014, the Northampton Community Preservation Committee voted unanimously to recommend that $300,000 in Community Preservation Act funds would be used for the support of this project. Now, therefore, it be ordered that $300,000 be appropriated from the Community Preservation Act funding to the Valley Community Development Corporation for the Lumberyard Affordable Housing Project for creation of 55 affordable units, and that the grantee meets the conditions approved by the Community Preservation Committee, the mayor, and the city council. Specifically, $159,000 is appropriated from the CPA Affordable Housing Reserve account, and $141,000 is appropriated from the CPA Budgeted Reserve account. We have a motion in finance. Second. Any more questions for the mayor? Just a fix of the unit count. Oh, yeah, it says it's December 18th. So do you have a motion in finance to amend the date to February 2nd?
So moved.
An amend? Second?
For any more minutes, yeah.
A couple more minutes. Let's hope we move right along on this one. All in favor of the amendment, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. And then to the main motion. If there are no more questions, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All right. And then the final issue is one that we moved from the last meeting since we spent 2 hours on resolutions. And by golly, we've done it again. And this is the study request that we got from the council president and vice president about how to make our budget hearings more scintillating for public attendance. And I might suggest, given the hour and the fact that we're again spent time on other things, that we move this along to perhaps another meeting. What's the wishes of the finance committee? Shall we request shall we pass this to another meeting?
Yes.
Shall we do that? All right. We got a motion and a second. All in favor of a positive recommendation on postponing?
Aye.
Excellent. Okay. But put your thinking caps on, because again, this is not a finance function. It's an entire council function, the budget hearing. So, hearing nothing else, seeing nothing else on the agenda, and I think we're ready to move along. A motion to adjourn. Second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Thank you.
Thank you. All right, we come out of recess. Right to 17.248. This is to rescind the previously approved council order due to error within the document. I'll accept a motion.
I move to take this one and the following one together as a group.
Okay. But then, of course, if it comes to suspension of rules, we'll have to focus on that. Okay. So that also includes the request is to combine item 17248 and also 17249. 17249 is the revised order to appropriate CPC funds for the Lumberyard Affordable Housing Project. So the motion.
I second.
Second. There was a motion to put it on the floor, both on the floor. Okay. Discussion on these items. As a group, roll call, please.
Councilor LaBarge.
Yes.
Councilor Murphy.
Yes.
Councilor
Yes.
Councilor
O'Donnell.
Yes.
Councilor Sherrill.
Yes.
Councilor
Carney.
Yes. Councilor Dwight. Yes.
Councilor Klein.
Yes.
Suspend 14.
Is that for both items? There's a motion made to suspend rules for both items. Is there a
second?
Second. Discussion on the suspension of rules. All those in favor of suspending rules to allow for a second reading, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Okay.
Move second reading for both.
Second reading has been moved for both and seconded. Any further discussion? Pam, roll call for both items, please.
Councilor Murphy.
Yes.
Councilor Nash.
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell.
Yes.
Councilor Sherrill.
Yes.
Councilor Bidwell.
Yes.
Councilor Carney.
Yes.
Councilor Dwight.
Yes.
Councilor Klein.
Yes.
Councilor LaBarge.
Yes.
Thank you. That's it's kind of critical. I think some of the funding stuff comes up on Monday. So deadline. So
actually, I needed to.
You need to
abstain from all of that. Yeah.
You. Let's acknowledge that.
I needed to. I apologize. So, I remember that the last time, but.
About the suspensions of rules. That was a voice vote anyway, so okay.
Yeah, all right.
Is it okay with the suspension of rules vote? Yes?
That doesn't express a conflict.
Probably not, no, but.
You want to abstain?
From the orders themselves.
And the rescission. Next up, we have item 17239. That's an order to authorize the creation of Stormwater and Flood Control Stabilization Fund and transfer free cash into the fund. This is second reading.
Second.
Any discussion on this item further? Roll call, please.
Councilor Nash.
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell.
Yes.
Councilor Sherrill.
Yes.
Councilor Bidwell.
Yes.
Councilor Carney.
Yes.
Councilor Dwight.
Yes.
Councilor Klein.
Yes.
Councilor LaBarge.
Yes.
Councilor Murphy.
Yes.
Passes in second reading. Item 17.240. This is an order to authorize the creation of a solid waste stabilization fund and transfer free cash into that fund. Second reading.
Move approval.
Second.
Motion's made and seconded. Any discussion? Roll call.
Councilor O'Donnell.
Yes.
Councilor Sherrill.
Yes.
Councilor Bidwell.
Yes.
Councilor Carney.
Yes.
Councilor Dwight.
Yes.
Councilor Klein.
Yes.
Councilor LaBarge.
Yes.
Councilor Murphy.
Yes.
Councilor Nash.
Yes.
Passes in second reading. Item 17.242 is an order to authorize the appropriation of free cash to MPS McKinney Vento Transportation Fund and Integrated Municipal Data System Capital Project Fund, second reading.
Move approval.
Motion's made and seconded. Any discussion? Roll call, please.
Counselor Shara?
Yes.
Counselor Bidwell?
Yes.
Counselor Carney?
Yes.
Counselor Dwight?
Yes.
Counselor Klein?
Yes.
Counselor LeBarge?
Yes.
Counselor Murphy?
Yes.
Counselor Nash?
Yes.
Counselor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Next up, item 17-24.
Oh, yeah. I think we skipped a couple.
Two. 237, 238.
Sorry.
17-239, please. In 240.
What about? I thought we did those, but we skipped 237 and 238.
Yes, we missed two of them.
At least that's the way I was.
Let's. I did miss 17-237.
And eight.
And I guess eight. I thought I did.
I think so.
I thought I did eight.
Well, it looks like
no. I think you went right to stormwater.
Okay. All right.
To stabilize.
Let's for fun. 17-237 is an order to transfer free cash to stabilization and stabilization funds. Second reading. Motion's made and seconded. Any discussion?
I'll text her.
Okay. Roll call, please.
Counselor Shara?
Yes.
Counselor Bidwell?
Yes.
Counselor Carney?
Yes.
Counselor Dwight?
Yes.
Counselor Klein?
Yes.
Counselor LeBarge?
Yes.
Counselor Murphy?
Yes.
Counselor Nash?
Yes.
Counselor
LeBarge?
Yes.
Okay, that passes in second reading. What are you showing reflecting as of not having a vote? Which item?
17-238.
Okay, so let's for fun. 17-238, this is an order to transfer retained earnings into stabilization funds for water and sewers.
Second reading.
Discussion? Roll call, please.
Counselor Bidwell?
Yes.
Counselor Carney?
Yes.
Counselor Dwight?
Yes.
Counselor Klein?
Yes.
Counselor LeBarge?
Yes.
Counselor Murphy?
Yes.
Counselor Nash?
Yes.
Counselor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Counselor Shara?
Yes.
Okay. Item 17.245, that's an order to accept Mass General Law, Chapter 44S, 53F3/4. That's its sexy title, as Counselor Murphy pointed out. That's a cable capital fund. Motion's made and seconded. Discussion? This is first reading. Roll call, please.
Counselor Bidwell?
Yes.
Counselor Carney?
Yes.
Counselor Dwight?
Yes.
Counselor Klein?
Yes.
Counselor LeBarge?
Yes.
Counselor Murphy?
Yes.
Counselor Nash?
Yes.
Counselor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Counselor Shara?
Yes.
That passes in first reading. Now we have an ordinance, 16.184. This is relative to heavy equipment operation. Second reading.
Move approval.
Seconded. Any further discussion on this? Roll call, please.
Counselor Carney?
Yes.
Counselor Dwight?
Yes.
Counselor Klein?
Yes.
Counselor LeBarge?
Yes.
Counselor Murphy?
Yes.
Counselor Nash?
Yes.
Counselor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Counselor Shara?
Yes.
Counselor Bidwell?
Yes.
Item 16.213, this is relative to parking on Center Street and Market Street with a positive recommendation from the Committee on Legislative Matters in second reading.
Second.
Motion's made and seconded. Any discussion? Roll call, please.
Counselor Dwight?
Yes.
Counselor Klein?
Yes.
Counselor LeBarge?
Yes.
Counselor Murphy?
Yes.
Counselor Nash?
Yes.
Counselor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Counselor Shara?
Yes.
Counselor Bidwell?
Yes.
Counselor Carney?
Yes.
All right. Passes in second reading. Item 16.214, this is relative to a yield sign on Maple Street with a positive recommendation from the Committee on Legislative Matters. Second reading.
Second.
Motion's made and seconded. Any discussion? Roll call, please.
Counselor Klein?
Yes.
Counselor LeBarge?
Yes.
Counselor Murphy?
Yes.
Counselor Nash?
Yes.
Counselor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Counselor Shara?
Yes.
Counselor Bidwell?
Yes.
Counselor Carney?
Yes.
Counselor Dwight?
Yes. All right, that yield sign's good. Item 17.244, this is an ordinance regarding fair minimum. Oh, bingo. Wait a minute. No, this is, I'm sorry, this is Councilor O'Donnell's. 17.244, it's a referral ordinance regarding fair minimum wage, and that's to be referred to the Committee on Finance and the Committee on Legislative Matters.
Move to refer to Finance and Legislative Matters.
Is there a second? Second. Any discussion on the referral? No? All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Any abstentions? I have no updates. There's no information requests. There's no new business.
Within 5 minutes of donut time.
Would anyone like to see the report?
I can do it back up.
Get that DP'd up.
You could, like, change the colors, maybe.
Let's call Antonio back. I'll accept a motion to adjourn.
Move to adjourn.
Second.
All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Thank you all very much.